How's it going, everybody? Micah Petit here, back in the reaction video, and we're here to return to the Journey to the West series. Yay, yay. Now, I told myself I was going to finish this entire series, or what they have left, before Sun Wukong comes out, Black Wukong comes out. That's not happening. I'm sorry about that. Because this comes out in, like, a few hours, and I have been slacking. Also, I have a new headset that I bought, like 2 hours ago, because my other one broke, and I'm like, I can't record videos on a headset, so here we are. But yeah, last episode, we had the gang got captured by this demon because Tripitaka and Pigsy are just so foolish. They're so foolish. No. Pigsy just loves getting in trouble. Tripitaka is so gullible. While even though Wukong told him, hey, don't go anywhere, they went somewhere. But yeah, after Wukong got the help of basically everybody, including Buddha, they managed to defeat the demon with the OP rain because Lao Tzu showed up and was like, hey, give me back my rain, demon. And that's how they basically saved the day. That's how Tripitaka and the crew were saved. But now we're here to see the next part in their adventure with Journey to the West Part 9. Yes, 9. So, let's roll it.
Last time on Journey to the West,
I keep forgetting
our heroes
a recap.
Lost Tripitaka to the icy machinations of an insidious weather-controlling demon. But the timely arrival of an uncharacteristically unkempt Kuan Yin tipped
too.
The scales in their favor and revealed the demon's true nature as her beloved pet goldfish. A real thing that I swear happened. With Tripitaka rescued once more, our heroes soon found themselves in deeper danger when a powerful mountain demon captured all but Sun Wukong.
He's strong and disarmed
the mighty Monkey King with Lao Tzu's diamond snare. With the help of old friends and older enemies, the Monkey King was able to defeat the demon, retrieve the stolen weapons, and rescue his companion so they could once more continue their journey to the west. So our heroes are trekking westward, the seasons are changing, and the frigid chill of winter has given way to the pleasant florals of early spring. And all things considered, this leg of the trip has been surprisingly uneventful. No demons,
red flag.
No bandits, no kidnappings, just a nice, pleasant, scenic filler arc. But our heroes face sudden adversity when the way is barred by a small, clear, freshwater brook. How will our heroes possibly overcome these insurmountable odds?
Fortunately, this
peaceful little brook comes with a scenic little boat that can take them across. But we can't be too careful. Maybe the boatman is evil. Nope, as it turns out, the boatman is a friendly old boatwoman who's more than happy to take them across the river with absolutely no nefariousness or kidnappings involved. Monkey is a little confused as to why a woman is doing what is typically a man's job, which the boatwoman finds funny but doesn't explain. So the gang crosses the river without incident, pays the ferry woman, and prepares to move on. But first, oh no! Horror of horrors! Tripitaka is thirsty.
No,
so
we need some water immediately.
Tasty river water for him. Now, PSA.
Why would you drink river? No, I wouldn't drink that. That's suspicious. I wouldn't drink any river water like that. No, do not do this, no matter how refreshing it looks. Seriously, there's germs and bugs and stuff. Why would you do that?
Drinking river water is typically a bad idea, since untreated water can make you sick. And sure enough, within a few minutes, Tripitaka and Pigsy both start feeling pretty lousy. The gang spot a village in the distance,
I'll just drink the river water. It won't do terrible things to my fragile human tummy. I can feel death icy clutch. Stop trusting Pigsy, Tripitaka. Stop it. Stop it. Why does he keep doing it?
Tripitaka and Pigsy both start feeling pretty lousy. The gang spot a village in the distance and hoof it over there to look for help, and Monkey flags down an old lady to ask her for medicine for his river water drinking buddies and their sore tum-tums. Unexpectedly, the old lady's like, hold on. Your men drank the river water. From that river. Yes? And they're both men. Last time I checked. Ooh, the girls are gonna love this.
Wait, are we in the village of women from last episode?
Women forms to spectate Tripitaka and Pigsy's strange affliction, all of whom seem to find this situation utterly hilarious.
Why?
Monkey's usually a big fan of schadenfreude and shenanigans, but even he's got his limits, and he grabs the old lady and demands an explanation. The old woman tells him that the boys have arrived at the outskirts of the Western Kingdom of Women, an entire empire populated solely by women. Women
Let's
do
go!
All the jobs, fill every social and political role, they're ruled by an empress instead of an emperor, and because there are no men, when a woman wants to have a child, she doesn't go about this the traditional way. Instead, she drinks from the child and mother stream, a magical river that makes anyone who drinks from it pregnant.
Oh. Oh yeah, I'm Sun Wukong right now. Hold on, let me move out the way. Oh. Oh my. Oh. Well, this has gotten wicked. This has gotten crazy now.
And where exactly is the child and mother stream located? Oh, you know, about 20 feet that way. That's why the ladies think Tripitaka and Pigsy's situation is so hilarious, and Monkey is fully inclined to agree. Tripitaka and Pigsy are, of course, very distraught, especially Pigsy, but Sandy gently cautions him that stress will hurt the baby.
Tripitaka is obviously
prepared to be a single parent, and more importantly, literally physically can't do it, and asks if there's any way for them to get unpregnant, and the woman tells him that there's no over-the-counter option that'll work on Magic River pregnancies, but there is a way. They just need to go to Mail Undoing Mountain, enter the child
Mail Undoing Mountain. Okay. Undo Mail Genitalia's Mountain.
Cave and drink the magic water from the Baby Begone stream. That's However, crazy. This isn't as easy as it sounds, and it doesn't sound all that easy. See, it's recently gotten a lot harder to access this stream because a Taoist called the True Immortal Compliant has taken over the mountain and now controls the water, and has been charging the women exorbitant prices for the tiniest glass of the stuff. There's no way a bunch of mendicant monks will be able to front the copay. This would be a big problem if Monkey was planning on paying for anything ever in his entire life. He leaves Sandy in charge and flies off to Mail Undoing Mountain to scope out the sitch. He runs into a Taoist disciple who tells him there's no way his master will give him the water for free, and Monkey suggests to tell his master that Sun Wukong is here to see if that changes his mind. This does in fact change his mind, but probably not in the direction Monkey wanted it to. As it turns out, the immortal is the older brother of the Bull Demon King and the uncle to Red Boy, and he's
That they had a great battle, Red Boy and Monkey King, or Sun Wukong. Wow, he's the uncle to Red Boy, who is I forgot what happened because Kuan Yin saved the day with that one.
Not too. As it turns out, the immortal is the older brother of the Bull Demon King and the uncle to Red Boy, and he's not too pleased about how Monkey got his precious nephew in trouble with the bureaucracy of heaven. You know how this song and dance goes. The immortal pulls out a weapon, in this case a gnarly hook, and they fight for a little while until Monkey starts winning and the immortal retreats back to the well. Now, while the immortal can't beat Monkey, he is frustratingly good at keeping him away from the water. And
in
the ensuing scrap, Monkey ends up fumbling the bucket and dropping it down the well.
Wait, what happens then?
He starts winning and the immortal retreats back to the well. Now, while the immortal can't beat Monkey, he is frustratingly good at keeping him away from the water, and in the ensuing scrap, Monkey ends up fumbling the bucket and dropping it down the well.
Oh, he drops the bucket down the well.
With no way to get the water now, Monkey heads back to the group to figure out a plan B.
Milo's rewards is here.
Can we get another bucket, or has it to be like that specific bucket to grab the water? I'm not sure. They don't let me know, but So I'm like, there's no way this regular jabroni, he's not regular jabroni, but this one guy can stop Sun Wukong. Like, there's no way. But he can't be a problem. He can't be a nuisance to him, which worked in his favor. Beyblade? What? Oh, I thought that was Beyblade. I was like, what the heck? And we're back.
So to get the water now, Monkey heads back to the group to figure out a plan B. So Monkey's new plan is that he'll distract the immortal while Sandy goes and gets the water. This plan does require leaving Tripitaka and Pigsy in the care of the old woman and her family, but she's pretty cool about it and promises not to hurt them. Monkey's like, look, no offense intended, but I kind of don't think you're capable of hurting literally any of us. And she's like, is that how you think this place works? Listen, son, you're all just lucky we're all too old to be interested in men anymore. If the young ladies around here had found you, you'd be having a much harder time going anywhere. With that taste,
No, my body is mine. The body belongs to me.
Just a little bit of foreshadowing dropped, Monkey and Sandy head back to the mountain, and Monkey taunts the immortal to lure him out. The disciple hypes the immortal up and tells him Monkey doesn't stand a chance of beating him, and with that optimistic forecast ringing in his ears, the immortal goes out to fight. While Monkey keeps him busy, Sandy heads for the well with a brand new bucket, and when the disciple tries to block the way, Sandy breaks his arm. Nicer option than killing him. He's reformed, remember? Sandy gets the water without too much trouble and calls for Monkey, who stops pretending like this is anywhere near a fair fight and blocks the immortal's hook.
Yeah,
since
like,
the
what
immortal
do you mean?
Hasn't really done anything wrong except blackmailing an entire community of women by holding their reproductive rights hostage, and Monkey still has respect for his brother, the Bull Demon.
Dang,
he just gives him a very stern warning to. And Monkey still has respect for his brother, the Bull Demon King. He just gives him a.
Okay, the armies of heavens couldn't stop me, and you think I was fighting you for real? I mean, yeah, like, what? you with your golden hook? You thought you just gotta stop Sun Wukong? That's insane.
Very stern warning to stop blackmailing people for the water and turns to leave. Obviously, the immortal is none too pleased about this and goes for a backstab, so Monkey sweeps the leg, grabs his hook, and snaps it in half. Thoroughly cowed, the immortal gives up, and Monkey and Sandy head back. Tripitaka and Pigsy drink the water, and one very alarming bowel movement later, are declared fully pregnancy-free. They leave the rest of the water with the old lady who helped them, who says this precious commodity will help cover the cost of her funeral. And with that delightful business sort sorted. Old lady who helped them, who says this precious commodity will help cover the cost of her funeral. And with that delightful business sorted out, our heroes are all set to continue their journey to the west, though I can't imagine Tripitaka is too happy with the concept of riding a horse right now. Sandy cautions them to take it easy, since new mothers are very delicate, officially confirming his status as the funniest person alive. So the gang continues westward and eventually reach a massive city, evidently the capital of the Kingdom of Women. Tripitaka tells the gang to be on their best behavior and to control themselves, which turns out to be a bit of a misread, since the minute they walk through the gates, they're swarmed by a mob of young women who've heard about this men thing and are very curious to learn more. Monkey has things to scare them off with his gross monster face, but even that doesn't dissuade them completely, since Tripitaka is evidently a very pretty man. Monkey and Sandy crank up the scare factor too, which, let's be honest, can't possibly work on all of these ladies, but it keeps the mob off them enough for them to make it through to a city official who guides them to a reception house and tells them they'll need to be announced to the throne and have their papers certified before they're allowed through the city.
Might be the scariest episode for them yet. These women seem to be unhinged in this area because, again, they probably haven't seen a man in eons. We'll see what happens. It can't be
the
that
gang
bad.
Is served a nice hot meal by a household of beautiful women, and meanwhile, the official legs it back to the palace to tell the queen what's going on. Now, the queen is very happy to hear about these visitors in her fine city because she happens to know that Tripitaka is basically blood brothers with the Tang Emperor, and if she wants to consolidate her power and guarantee the continuation of her family line, she can do that very effectively by marrying Tripitaka. The official tells her that while Tripitaka is indeed a legit snack, his three disciples are a lot more spicy. The queen doesn't mind letting the disciples continue their journey westward, but their oh-so-juicy master will be staying with her.
Oh, see, that's what we're not gonna do, sister. That's what we're not gonna do. We need Tripitaka. He is the leader. He is the person. We need him with us, sister.
While the queen gets a matchmaker on the horn, the official heads back to give Tripitaka the good news. Speaking of whom, Tripitaka and the gang are enjoying their meal when they hear that the grand preceptor wants a word with them, which has Tripitaka a little confused until Monkey nonchalantly says the queen probably wants to marry him. Tripitaka unsurprisingly panics, but Monkey tells him that if marriage is on the table, Tripitaka should say yes and then let Monkey handle everything. Sure enough, the preceptor heads in with the queen's proposal.
I've received hand in marriage. You've received kingdom, wealth, dowry, life, and luxury. Disciples, continue your quest. Spectacular bonking. Spectacular bonking. All right. Yep, that seems like a pretty equal trade to me.
Proposal offering to make Tripitaka the queen's royal consort with the entire wealth of the kingdom as his dowry. The disciples will obviously be allowed to continue their journey and get to the Thunderclap Monastery on their own time, which means this technically wouldn't even mean giving up the quest. Tripitaka is dead silent, but Pigsy announces that there's no way Tripitaka would ever agree to that, which is why the queen should ask him instead. Tripitaka asks Monkey what he thinks, and Monkey's like, honestly, dude, sounds like a pretty sweet deal. The preceptor heads off to make the arrangements, and Tripitaka immediately grabs Monkey by the lapels and asks him what the hell he thinks he's doing. Tripitaka can't get married, he's a Buddhist monk, a really, really devoted one.
Yeah,
this is terrible. Monkey tells him to chill out and points out.
Well, if you're sure we can tell. Well, if you're sure we can tell the Empress you declined and murder our way out of when she gets mad and tries to stop us, you know, my plan C. Okay, so we'll go.
The turning the queen down flat was never going to work out well for them. The people of this kingdom are humans, innocent ones.
That's true,
If they had to fight them, they'd obviously win, but they'd be killing innocent people in the process, something Tripitaka has historically frowned upon.
Can we just
Tripitaka
escape?
Admits
just escape.
He didn't think of that, and Monkey lays out his cunning alternative plan, a husband heist. They're gonna go through with the wedding, throw a huge banquet, get all their paperwork in order, and then when Tripitaka tearfully sees them off at the edge of the city, Monkey will use his magic to freeze everyone for a whole day while they book it off into the sunset.
He can do that?
Plan, all
okay,
things considered.
Sure.
Meanwhile, the queen hears her proposal's been accepted and piles into a royal carriage to meet her future boo. She finds Tripitaka just as pretty as she'd hoped for, despite him being too flustered to speak, and she invites him into the carriage to head for the wedding hall. Tripitaka pretends to be totally cool with this, even though all he wants is to be a good Buddhist and get some scriptures, dang it. So the gang head for the wedding hall and enjoy the beautiful and ornate wedding party, and at Tripitaka's request, the queen recertifies their paperwork and agrees to wait until tomorrow to officially put him on the throne. The wedding party wraps up and the plan rolls into its final stages.
Okay.
Tripitaka politely asks if he can see his disciples off one final time, and the queen obviously agrees, and they pile into the chariot to see them off at the edge of town.
Kind of sad because you're kind of playing with the queen's feelings. Well, I mean, I don't think the queen really cares about Tripitaka that much. She just wants to get married inside and to protect her family. But yeah, it's kind of messed up. You're playing with the queen. But it's like probably the... But no, they could just escape the city. What am I talking about? They could just escape. These are literal demons here. We could just escape. We don't have to fight nobody. What's going on here?
Followed by a massive mob of beautiful young women. When Tripitaka steps out of the carriage to say his goodbyes, he drops the pretenses and very gently asks the queen to let him continue on his journey. The queen is very upset about
what
him
are you
suddenly
doing,
changing his
what
mind,
are you doing?
But Pigsy scares her back, and it looks like the gang is going to manage to leave without anything worse than a broken heart, until a girl sprints out of the crowd, tells Tripitaka he should try boning her instead, grabs him, and vanishes in a cyclone. Finally, a demon showed up. I'm starting to get worried.
The demon
out and blasts off to look for Tripitaka, which has the unexpected side effect of giving the queen closure, since she didn't realize these monks could, like, fly and stuff. Her officials agreed that Tripitaka and his disciples were so dang Buddhist that her marriage scheme was never going to break his iron will, and the queen and her court head back to the palace, dejected but recovering.
Okay,
and meanwhile,
that's
good. The gang chased the cyclone until it disappears into a standard issue demon mountain lair. Pigsy wants to kick in the door, but Monkey wants to scout first to make sure it's the right door, so he turns into a bee and sneaks in. He finds a surprisingly beautiful flower field with a female demon chilling in it, attended by young women serving her a pleasant meal of red bean buns and also human flesh buns. The attendants also bring in Tripitaka, and the demoness pleasantly offers him a bun.
Would I say man meat?
Also, human flesh buns. The attendants also.
Hey, Hanson, care for some man meat? Maybe show a little more clavicle too. Let me see that clavicle. What's that clavicle looking like?
Also bring in Tripitaka, and the demoness pleasantly offers him a bun. Tripitaka is very aware that this situation is a lot more dangerous
very
than his
dangerous.
Last unwilling marriage, so he plays it safe and politely turns down the human bun.
That butt sure isn't. That is. Ridiculous. Okay.
He realizes that he's vegetarian, but accepts the red bean bun and makes polite conversation while he waits for the gang to come rescue him. The demoness makes some very inappropriate jokes that Tripitaka is too much of a soft boy to get, but Monkey is infuriated by her lascivious puns and attacks. The attendants bundle Tripitaka away while the demoness whips out a trident and clashes with Monkey. The battle ends up taking them straight out the door and down the mountain, at which point Sandy and Pigsy both join in, which unexpectedly does not help, as the demoness whips out two more tridents and boasts that while Monkey might not recognize her, the Buddha himself knows and fears her. With that, she...
Wait, Buddha fears her? Buddha? The Buddha fears her? Who is this chick? Who is this demon lady? Hold on. Tridents. Look, do I know? From my smite experience, do I know any gods or demons? Not Kali. She has, like, the six arms with this... Demon with two tridents. I don't have any body in my mind. I don't know.
And boasts that while Monkey might not recognize her, the Buddha himself knows and fears her. With that, she jumps into the air and stabs down with something Monkey can't quite make out because he's a little too distracted by the horrible blinding pain. With Monkey incapacitated, the fight turns very quickly, and the gang books it while the demoness heads back into the mountain for the night. Monkey has no idea what she hit him with that could have actually...
Out of curiosity, how would you compare this pain to childbirth on a scale from 1 to drunken molten copper... while crushed under a mountain for 500 years? Solid eight. Dang, that's pain. That's super pain.
Really hurt him because his skull turned indestructible about 3 immortalities ago, but whatever it was, he's in no position to fight. So they rest for the night and hope they can figure something out in the morning. Meanwhile, the demoness sets her sights on seducing Tripitaka, which, as previously established, is a losing battle even in ideal circumstances. Tripitaka, politely but firmly, turns her down for hours before she snaps and has her minions tie him up and get him out of her sight. The next morning, Monkey's feeling way better, so he sneaks into the cave to see how Tripitaka's doing, finding him very disgruntled.
You know, I was tied up for perfectly kosher reasons.
But thoroughly unboned. Tripitaka accidentally wakes up the demoness by loudly declaring that Monkey needs to rescue him right this minute because...
Wait, I don't want anything to do with that powder Godiva.
Because he's totally uninterested in boning anyone, and the only thing he cares about is getting those scriptures.
That
means it's about 5 o'clock, so Monkey zips out of the cave and Pigsy smashes the door in. They fight for a while before the demoness whacks Pigsy in the face with that mysterious weapon and puts him out of commission. He heads back inside to stew while Monkey and Sandy try to figure out their next move. They're not having that much luck fighting the demon because they're really not even sure what she is.
But luckily,
Monkey spots an unassuming old lady nearby who's positively radiant with auspicious light and realizes Kuan Yin must have gotten impatient.
Is Kuan Yin? Yeah, and Kuan Yin's like, it's about time for me to step in. It's Kuan Yin.
And come by to see what the holdup was. Kuan Yin reveals herself and explains that the demoness is actually a scorpion. The tridents she uses are her claws, and the mysterious weapon that keeps taking them out is her stinger tail, loaded with a seriously potent poison. She used to listen in on Buddha's lectures until one day she got snippy, stung his hand, and ran. Hence why even the Buddha fears her. Kuan Yin also says she can't help them directly, but she knows who can, and points Monkey in the direction of Star-Lord Mao, the spirit of one of the 28 lunar mansions corresponding to the Pleiades.
Okay.
Kuan Yin pieces out, and Monkey zips up to heaven to track down Star-Lord Mao, bouncing around a bit before he eventually finds him.
Sounds like there's no time to waste on common tea. Okay.
Monkey explains the situation, and Star-Lord Mao declares there's no time to waste on pleasantries, and they book it back to the mountain.
Star-Lord Mao
magically cures the lingering effects of the scorpion demon's poison, so Monkey and Pigsy are back in fighting form and smash down the door again to lure out the demoness, which is when Star-Lord Mao reveals his true form in all his divine glory as a 7-foot chicken.
Let's go! 7-foot chicken! We'd love to see it!
Huh. Star-Lord Mao, now a chicken, crows twice, transforming the demoness back to her true scorpion form and paralyzing her, which lets Pigsy kill her without too much trouble. Star-Lord Mao beams back up to heaven, and the gang traipses into the cave to rescue Tripitaka. And the demon's attendants, who it turns out were all kidnapped girls from the Kingdom of Women. They return the kidnapped women to their homes before getting back on the road and setting off once more on their journey to the west. Our heroes have overcome another obstacle, but the way is only getting more treacherous. Will the Monkey King's strength be enough to protect Tripitaka from what lies ahead?
Maybe.
Find out next time.
Maybe.
On Journey to the West.
It seems like the further we go with the Journey to the West, like the more episodes we go in, the more powerful enemies they face, because Sun Wukong couldn't do anything really. He had to get help again without putting much of it. Well, the other enemy that they fought in the last episode, he could fight, it's just that the ring was too powerful. It's like they couldn't get past the ring without help. But this demon, the red demon, right? The red demon girl, she seems like, yeah, we can't beat her. This mysterious stinger thing that she's doing, we can't beat her. We need help. We don't even know how to even approach the situation. Ah, dang. He might not be strong enough, actually, to fight against, like, the other villains. I don't know. Other demons. I don't know. I'm not sure. But that was a good episode. That was fun.
Edomika and Shura.
Let that play out for a bit. I will say, that's probably the scariest encounter Tripitaka has been in, because he's a devoted Buddhist. He cannot be in these types of relationships, and he almost lost it. And he almost birthed a child. That's wild. Yeah, so I think the lessons we can take for today is don't drink water from the river. You don't know what could be in there. Yeah, that's like the main takeaway from this video. Tripitaka got kidnapped like he always does, and they solved it. I feel like there's gonna be one situation where Tripitaka gets captured, and it's looking like, yeah, not even all the help in the world can save you this time. And I gotta figure out, and maybe the horse will actually do something again. He will actually turn into his true form and help. Because he only did that once. And that was like really early on in the series. but yeah, I'm gonna head out of here now. A couple more videos I'm gonna check out. I'm gonna see if I can get this uploaded before tomorrow, because that's when Black Myth Wukong comes out. And yeah, we'll see what happens. So hope you enjoy my reaction, and thank you for watching. My cup of tea's out of here. See you later. That would have been a very interesting situation if they had to give birth to those two children, those two kids, Pigsy and Tripitaka. See, this is why you do not trust Pigsy. When Pigsy gives you something, you do not trust it. You say, I don't know about you. I trust someone who will call him more. And this man is a trickster. But he has shown time and time that he can get the job done. He can act serious when he needs to.